Hello, YouTube, Mystery Report Newsletter, and Tutor Chat subscribers. This is Terral from Terral03.com. Today is February the 3rd, 2020, and this is the Mystery Report Newsletter number 9 for 2020. I'll give you a coronavirus update here in a second. First, this weekly newsletter program is all about helping people see God's wisdom hidden in plain sight using His three witnesses of spirit, blood, and water, testifying in the Holy Scriptures from Genesis 1:1 through Revelation. Once you see it, it's really a miraculous thing. Then Gary is the man after my heart this week, and he has some interesting questions that we're going to get into here in a minute. But John, look what John did. All of these, see this number 9? He's been giving us one a week. This is from my 2012 series at Awakened Radio. All of the Black Star Update report part that starts each video has been removed. And this is where, this is John's work. And he sent all of these. This is a real treasure trove of information for those that are in the, that are subscribers to the Mystery Report program. This is the link to last week's chat right there. And remember, every Tuesday night, that's tonight, from 7 to 9 p.m., then we have Bible study chat. And if you're a subscriber, then you're going to get all the information in your notification email, where to go, where to register, and everything you need to know, even the password, if we use one, if we have too much trouble with troublemakers. Then, before we get into Gary's questions, then the special notice that Black Star and Mystery Report newsletter subscribers inside the continental United States, this is anywhere in the United States, by the way, can purchase the NanoSilver for a $50 donation at the website. That includes shipping. That's enough to make 6 liters. That's over 12 pints. For a $50 donation, includes shipping outside. And this should have been changed already. My apologies for that. If you go to the website, let me clear this up before, then this is the way we're going. This is it. We're no longer using the donate button down there. There's no addresses confirmed. It makes my job very difficult. Now this is set up so that you're going to fill in your, whenever you use these buy now buttons, then there's a place for you to confirm your mailing address right inside of there. So these, when I get the notification, it comes in confirmed and makes my job a whole lot easier. So if you're inside the United States, it's $50 for per order. And if you're international, it's $100 per order. You remember, per order, that's over $600 worth of NanoSilver. Next, let's get back over to the newsletter. Quite a bit to cover. So in today's, or this week's lesson, then Gary's asked some interesting questions. And we're just going to start off. Hi, Terral. In 1 Kings 1:17, starting at verse 7, Elijah was sent to the widow. Commentaries say that Sidon was in an area that was heavy into worship of Baal, which the entire region and the children of Israel and everybody else were worshiping. The prophets of Baal, there were lots of those guys running around. There was only one of Elijah. And other prophets of their different gods and things like that, false gods. Jesus himself spoke of Elijah being set as an example of God's right to choose how he dispenses his grace, as written in Mark chapter 6. That part kind of threw me a little bit as I read the passage. And there is a mention of Elijah there, but not necessarily of dispensing of grace. Go through the Old Testament and good luck finding one Hebrew word that is translated into faith more than one time, because it doesn't exist. And then grace is going to be favor, unlike the grace of God that is salvation by grace through faith, apart from works, Ephesians 2, 8, 9. That type of grace does not exist in the Old Testament. There's nobody that's going to heaven in the Old Testament. There's nobody that's imputed with the righteousness of God like we are by obeying the gospel. There's no Hebrew or Aramaic term in the Old Testament used that is translated into the word gospel. That's the foolishness of the message preached, 1 Corinthians 1:17 and 18. That's a New Testament concept. So my question is based upon watching your video on Adam and learning that Elijah has different skins, such as John the Baptist, etc., and trying to understand where Adam and Elijah fit into in this story and why the Lord would send Elijah to Sidon and no one else in the famine, and how the story fits into the four Gospels. The longer, because we're going to have correspondence later, and there's going to be a little misunderstanding in semantics here, but it's helpful to me if you make a sentence. See how this is a run-on sentence, and it's three long? So I'm going to have to read this more than once to try to grasp what you're saying. And saying it's easy, the longer your sentence gets, the easier it is for me to interpret a phrase that you're using in a different way than you actually mean. Is the story directed to the people of the two kingdoms of grace or in heaven, or just those who are left behind after the rapture? Or is it the purpose to show to all the sole power of God's election, as commentaries say? Or, see, these long sentences can get us in trouble. Whenever you're sending your questions, I just recommend that you break them into small noun, verb, direct object, noun, verb, direct object, rather than the run-on where I have lots of nouns and lots of pronouns and lots of verbs, and it's difficult for me to ascertain. It's not an understanding of what you're saying, per se. It's the fact that words can be interpreted different ways, and then you can appear to be saying different things. So, or just those who are left behind after the rapture, or is it the purpose to show the sole power of God's election, as commentaries say, or is there more? But whenever you mention commentaries, there are a lot, tons and tons and tons and tons of commentaries from different denominations. It's kind of difficult for me to comprehend what that means, really. I gather from your work that it appears to be a water witness only, but I'm uncertain since it deals with God's grace as spoken of by Paul. I would appreciate any additional enlightenment that you may add. Okay. And as I said, there's going to be a little misunderstanding there. So I read it and I read it again, and then I'm going to give it my best shot, based upon the terms that you're using and the weight of my understanding at that time. Okay, so, and my practice is to show your entire thought expressed and then to start breaking it up. The question is based on the video on Adam, and there's been a couple of those. And learning that Elijah has different skins, such as John the Baptist. So please allow me to slow you down here to point out that both Elijah and John, like Abraham, Joshua, and David, are skins for our father Adam. So it's not that Elijah has skins, or John the Baptist has skins, or David or Joshua. Adam has skins. Genesis 3:21, when they're put in skins, I know a lot of people think they see the Lord God out there whittling down an animal and putting the animal skin. That's not what he's talking about. Everything before Genesis 3:21 in the Bible, from Genesis 2:7, when Adam is made with Eve inside, and then Eve's taken out, that's heaven. That's a heaven thing. They're, whenever they're driven from the garden, that's the heavenly garden, they're driven down to the earthly garden. On earth as it is in heaven, on earth as it is in heaven. That's a phrase from Matthew 6:10, when Christ is teaching them how to pray. Well, they're actually teaching how John taught them how to pray. It's the way the question goes. But anyway, that's the theme that we're going to be looking at here, that is going to, we're going to be summing up. This is the way it begins. This is the way this is going to end after two emails. So therefore, it's not that Elijah has skins, but Adam is one of the two olive trees. And I'm going to repeat that near the end. And you'll notice that's kind of my practice as I'm sewing things up. Because whenever it's going to be presented here, but it's going to be presented again at the end. And then everything in the middle is going to, it's like the bread that's holding the sandwich, the heart of the sandwich inside. So Adam is one of the two olive trees from Zechariah 4:11 through 14 from the garden, who return again and again to testify to their obedient, her seed, and disobedient, your seed, children. That's from the prophecy of Genesis 3:15. This is precisely what Adam and Eve are doing as the two witnesses of Revelation near the end of the age. So whenever you're reading Revelation 11, you'll notice that the powers that the two witnesses have are the same exact powers of Elijah and Moses. Same exact powers. But the thing to see the depth of what God is showing you is that the powers of Moses and the powers of Elijah are the powers of Adam and Eve, the original cultivators of the land of the garden. They had the power to call down the fire of the Lord from heaven, burn off the land. They had the power to bring the rain or to make the rain go away. The powers of the Garden of Eden. When you see Moses and Elijah standing next to Christ, Matthew 17, you're looking at the Lord God who made Adam and Eve, Elijah and Moses. Moses is a type, is a skin for your mother Eve, just like Noah is, just like Bathsheba, just like Sarah for Abraham, Bathsheba for King David. These two olive trees come again and again and again. There are three begotten souls in God's word. The Lord God, our Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son. Adam, who was formed, made by the Lamb of God, the Lord God's hands, and Eve that was pulled out. So Adam and Eve, they're the two olive trees that got no belly button. In other words, not born of women. But then, with each of their skins, they are born of women, you see. That's of John the Baptist. Christ says that of all those that are born of women, there's none greater than John the Baptist. But what he's saying is that John the Baptist is another skin for Adam. Because there's none greater than your father, right? Well, keep going back in time, and eventually, everybody's coming from Adam and Eve. Seventh-day people, anyway, from his recent incarnation, Genesis 3:21. So they're testifying again and again, over and over again, to their obedient children. That's when Moses comes to Israel. And they're baptized into Moses and in the sea, 1 Corinthians 10. They're being baptized back into their mother from which they came, mother of all living, Genesis 3:20. So when you begin to see the wisdom of the two witnesses coming again, yes, it's for a man to die once. And then the judgment, Hebrews 9:27. Yes, that's true. For every seventh-day person, it's true. You, me, everybody else. But it's not true for the original garden pair. That's why you see Elijah going to heaven without seeing death, because Adam is testifying through Elijah for all the, guess who? Angels. Angels do not see death. Elijah didn't see death. Moses, a type of, or a skin for Eve, had to see death. Moses, they're going to the promised land. Moses, no, you can't go. You can't go across the veil that represents the division between earth and heaven. Because flesh and blood, you got to die to go to heaven. Moses had to die. And the water witnesses, she is the water witness. So, done a lot of background. Shared a lot of background information on that. So, Gary's question. My question is based on watching your video of Adam, that Elijah has different skins, such as John the Baptist, etc., and trying to understand where Adam and Elijah fit in the story. When the Lord would send Elijah to Sidon and no one else in the famine, and how the story fits into the two Gospels. This is where it's having a little bit of difficulty, because Elijah, the three witnesses are right there. Elijah is the spirit witness. The widowed woman is the water witness. The child that he raises from the dead is the blood witness. Now, that's in the three principal characters. The seed that came out of Eve's side, Eve and her seed came from Adam's side. That's a witness of water and blood. The type of that is Christ on the cross. Stick the spear in, what comes out? Water and blood. Christ came in water and blood, not water only, but in water and with blood. So there's these types all mesh together to teach you as different spirit witnesses, water witnesses, and blood witnesses, all testifying simultaneously as a chorus in Scripture to become angel song. And once you hear it, it's really a magnificent thing. So while answering the who, because there's a why here. Why? The who, the what, the when, and the where question is relatively simple to determine by reading the Holy Scriptures. The why questions requiring us to enter God's mind are most difficult to answer. And the thing is, people have so many different interpretations. Even if you tell the truth, then it's going to be perceived as subjective. It's going to be perceived as an opinion. Even though, after you spend decades with these types, the word's going to tell you what the answer is. Once the realization dawns that God is placing Adam and Eve in different human skins in a series of different incarnations, then we can begin connecting the dots about God's eternal purpose, characterized by Paul as the whole purpose of God. So this is another phrase for this is purpose for the ages, Ephesians 3:11, when Paul's describing the mystery. We can discern from Scripture that Elijah was tested severely in his walk among the sons of Israel, as the prophet believed himself to be totally alone. This is what it says, Romans 11. God has not rejected his people, who he foreknew. Or do you not know that the Scripture says, the passage about Elijah, this is where he's mentioned there, how he pleads with God against Israel. Lord, they have killed your prophets. They have torn down your altars, and I alone and left, and they are seeking my life. But what was the divine response to him? I have kept for myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to Baal. This is a recreation of what was going on in God's infinite realm when Satan was taking down Adam. The reason for the heaven and earth being created is the restoration of Adam's infinite body using the heaven and the earth, the heaven being the incarnation of the last Adam, Christ. Christ is heaven. And Adam is the earth, the man of the earth. The first Adam and the last Adam to be restored. That's what all this is about. It's like restoring the soul, heaven, of Adam, and the body, earth, of Adam, so that the two can become one and go back to the infinite realm. All is like Humpty Dumpty. All broken, all eggshell and yolk, everything, everywhere. God restores the soul and body of Adam one member at a time in the earth as it is in heaven. Now, heaven and earth are connected. Very important to realize that. That's why Christ uses the phrase so many times, on earth as it is in heaven. That's why we see it. And whenever he's teaching the kingdom disciples how to pray. So Israel was seeking Elijah's life in much the same way Israel allowed John to die in prison at Herod's hand, and Israel repeatedly proclaimed, crucify him to the Lord God, who made him in the garden. We should keep in mind that God is using these examples as types in the lives of Elijah, Joshua, David, John the Baptist, even in the story of Abraham and Sarah, that I didn't mention here, to teach about Adam living under the God of this world, that are replays of what already happened in God's infinite realm where you are God's. Elijah is a spirit witness, the woman is a water witness, and her child, like her seed, is the begotten blood witness. The bowl has an exhaustible supply, seed, that is the blood witness, where the bowl is the vessel. So it's into the vessel that the water witness, that the water goes. The oil is the spirit. Oil is the spirit witness. When you look at the charts that are in my book, then you'll see that oil, bread, and water are three witnesses that testify for the bread, Christ being the bread of life. He's the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. The oil, you see, the seed, and the water witness, who's the helper, that's the Holy Spirit. So put these three witnesses together, and you have Elijah, the woman, and her son living from the bowl where the oil, seed, and water, those three witnesses, in the vessel, you see, become like manna from heaven that sustains the trio throughout the drought period. Never-ending supply, inexhaustible. It's always the blood witness that enlarges. That'd be the bread in the middle. When you put all the three witnesses together, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, you get the word. That's the bread. I am the bread of life. God uses the three witness mystery sets. I'm sorry, there should be a hyphen there. God uses the three witness mystery set types in Genesis 1:1 and throughout the entire Bible, like you see here in 1 Kings 17. And one of the most powerful verses of the Bible, my opinion, my view, 1 Kings 17:1. Shall not rain unless Elijah says so. So that we can see his holy wisdom, or his wisdom hidden very much in plain sight using three witnesses of spirit, blood, and water. Elijah would be taken to heaven in the chariot of fire to not see death like the angels, who are the spirit witnesses dwelling in the spirit witness heavens on the far side of heaven. Elijah is the prophet who stepped from behind the second veil of the Holy Scriptures to begin clearing the way for the Lord, preaching the gospel of the kingdom. So the early reigns, kingdom bride, Peter, John, and James, could be chosen, Romans 11:7, and given eternal life, becoming the royal priesthood who served before the Lamb in heaven. Those of us obeying our gospel, the grace of God, are members of the Lamb's body, already being seated with Jesus Christ in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, from where we judge the world and the angels. Gary's question. Is the story directed to the people of the two kingdoms of grace and kingdom in heaven, or just to those who are left behind after the rapture? Or is it the purpose to show to all the sole power of God's election, as commentaries say? Or is it more? It's a difficult, the way it's worded, it was a little bit difficult for me, and especially when we go back to looking at the Old Testament, the types of the three witnesses in Elijah, the woman, and her son. Then there was something that I missed right along in here. But when you're talking about two kingdoms, this is what kind of threw me: the kingdoms, two kingdoms of grace in heaven, because the word that we're looking for here, and in my debate with dispensationalists at ChristianForums.com. This is what's going to be down in the clarifying statements, where a dispy is confusing a dispensation with a kingdom. Because if you put the word, this word I have highlighted here, kingdoms, if you put the word dispensation there, you see the two dispensations of grace, that's Paul, Barnabas, and Titus, and two kingdoms of grace in heaven. See, if the dispensation of grace would be us, and those that are inheriting the kingdom of heaven through the gospel of the kingdom, then that's going to be Peter, John, and James. So, the two kingdoms of grace in heaven, the kingdom of grace, that threw me. Because that's not in Scripture. Or just those who are left behind after the rapture, okay, those are water witness, they are obeying the gospel of the kingdom, they're going to be added as late rains bride to Peter, John, and James standing on the sea of glass. Revelation 7, start at 14. Or is the purpose to show all the sole power of God's election, as commentaries say, or is it more? So, two kingdoms, great, you know, then I'm going to show you the kingdom of God. This is the infinite realm. This is Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. But when you get further down in my book, these three witness mystery sets become more complicated. The diagrams have many more parts. And in this diagram here, for example, you can see that earth and heaven above and the heavens. Well, when you're a member of Christ's body and you're in heaven as a member of the body of the Lamb, this is the earth. This whole realm is the earth of Genesis 1:1. And we're looking up into heaven of Genesis 1:1. See, this visible universe here is the earth of Genesis 1:6-8. That's the waters below the expanse, below the firmament. That's here. This is the firmament, heaven, Genesis 1:8. This is the waters above. Heavens existed long ago. This is 2 Peter 3:5. And the earth was formed out of water and by water. The water witnesses down here. The clues are all there in the scriptures, but God's hidden his wisdom within the types of spirit, blood, and water. Once you can see it. Okay. So, to the member of Christ's body, we're a member of the Lamb. We're in the earth here, just like we're down here. We're in the earth of Genesis 1:1, though. And when we look up into heaven. And we are already seated in these heavenly places here. We have an incarnation in this almost infinite realm, and we have an incarnation here as a member of the Lamb's body in this creation. This is a finite host. This is an almost infinite host. Give you some idea. You as a God here, infinite host. All the ages of the heaven and earth will pass before one split second passes in the infinite realm. That's what it means to be almost infinite and finite relative to a realm that is infinite. Both of these realms put together is like a drop of water compared to the infinite realm. If that. Even at the end of the ages, that's the difference. So, there's a kingdom of God, there's a kingdom, and that the kingdom part up there threw me. So I went off kind of on this tangent explaining about the kingdoms. So there's a kingdom of God, that's God's infinite realm. On the left, we can see the kingdom of God's beloved Son in figure 2, that corresponds to heaven of Genesis 1:1. Then we can see the kingdom of this world in figure 3, that illustrates the heavens, heaven, and the earth. There's no such kingdom of grace and no age of grace either. I kind of threw this in, the key wording of your what you're sending me reminds me of debating dispies, dispensationalists. And there's different kinds, traditionalists, progressives, the hypers, Acts 2 dispies, Acts 9 dispies, Acts 13 dispies, Acts 28, 28 dispies, and then they continue dividing and dividing and dividing. There's such a thing as rightly dividing the word of truth. We use the old King James, which is cut straight in the Greek. And there's also such thing as too much dividing. Dividing what God has put. Well, anyway. I'd learned from dispies. Love debating with dispies. Matter of fact, whenever you go to ChristianForums.com, this is the room that I go to. Right here. And it is it's general theology. But it is the dispensationalism room. Why? Not because I'm a dispensationalist, but because this room has dispensationalists in there. At least they know what a dispensation is, a household that lives under different house rules. And so we can kind of have a debate about Peter, John, and James being the kingdom, obeying the gospel of the kingdom, being the kingdom church, and then Paul, Barnabas, and Titus being the mystery body of Christ church. Paul had to go submit the gospel he preaches among the Gentiles because Peter, John, and James didn't know about it. They thought Paul's new people being brought into the body of Christ church were kingdom disciples. That's why they were thought they had circumcised them, because they have to keep the law. Matthew 5, 17 through 19. That heaven and earth will not pass. There's not one dot's going to come from the law until heaven and earth passes away, and that's Revelation 20, 15. Those that are living through the day of the Lord, the kingdom disciples, are going to live under the law. That's what James is saying in James 2:10. You keep the whole law and you break one little point, you're guilty of breaking the whole law. That's what kingdom disciples are going to live under through the day of the Lord, but they're going to have the Holy Spirit in their body, the power of the Holy Spirit. We're not talking about this earnest of inheritance thing that we have. We're talking about the power. They're going to be able to raise the dead. Do all kinds of things. So it's different for them than it is for those of us being called to God through the gospel, the grace of God, having only an earnest of our inheritance. Because he has to save us by his grace through faith. If there's great signs and wonders happening, it isn't by faith, is it? It's by what? Sight, so what you can see. We walk by faith and not by sight. We're a totally different household. We're called for something different than Peter, John, and James. So this is the place that you go to. Just wanted to invite you guys to show up over there at ChristianForums.com, the dispensationalism room. You can comment on my posts. That's where most of them are posted. I'm not even posting now at the religiousforums.com. It's just not enough action over there. Okay. So I showed you the diagram. I'm giving the explanation of it right here. Okay, so God chooses the time. I missed a line up here. Members of Christ's body see these things first as blood witnesses of the holy text, with our angel and man halves already sewn back together again, allowing us to be seated in the heavenly places. So you cannot be seated in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus up here unless your angel half and your man half are already put back together again. Take the woman, put her back inside the man. Take the man, put him back inside the angel. And you have an immortal soul like Adam was in Genesis 2:7. That's what we are here. That's what we are as members of the Lamb's body here. We're immortal. We're indestructible, glorified, cannot kill. You can kill the man that lives down here. You cannot kill the angel of the heavens either. But whenever you put the angel to get back, the man back inside the angel, and you have a glorified immortal soul, that guy is indestructible. It's greater than the sum of the parts, greater than the angel and the man put together when you put them back the way they're supposed to be. So the difference in Peter, John, and James and us, we have our angel half already put back together again. We're already seated up in here. Peter, John, and James, they're standing on the sea of glass. Their angel half is on the invisible sea behind them. Whenever the marriage supper of the Lamb happens, there's an angel and a man. The glorified in heaven, we're talking about Peter, John, and James, but their angel half is not reconnected yet. That's what the marriage supper of the Lamb's all about. Their angel half and their man half, I'll be showing you down here in the bottom, are hooked back up. That's how they join us in the Lamb, to then be jealous as heck because they see how glorious we are and how they appear to be like women compared to us. No such thing as men and women in heaven. But between by the body of Christ and the bride that joins us later, let me tell you something. The Greek calls him the bride for a reason. John the Baptist calls him a bride for a reason because they're like the girls of the body of Christ. It's going to be two groups. Even though there's one body, well, right? Right. Except for whenever they come by works and join us in Christ, then it's nothing like the power of God that he's bestowed in us. We are kings and rulers. They are priests. We're like the men, masculine. They're like the feminine side. And they're going to wear that, those symbols of feminism, femininity, whatever you call it. The stones in their chest plates are going to show it. Their garments are going to show it. We're going to be the kings and rulers. And they're going to be made kings and rulers too, made kings and rulers through the marriage supper of the Lamb by washing their garments and washing and scrubbing and works and works and works. God gave us for free. Same thing God gave us for free. Now we're building upon that with our good works. We weren't created, we weren't saved by works, but we were created for good works. Ephesians 2, 8, read all the way through 10. So then, let's see, this is where I was originally. My apologies for losing my place there. There's no kingdom of grace, no age of grace. That's what I hear from Dispies a lot. God's wisdom is intended for all of God's children to understand at some point in the timeline. Members of Christ's body see things first. There are things within the veil of the Pauline epistles. It's covered on both sides by the first and second veils, the soul of the scriptures. Old Testament prophets can't see it. New Testament disciples, they can't see it either. They cannot see it. Like many people walking around today can't see it. The three witnesses. We're inside those two veils. That's where we live. And the Pauline epistles were written to us specifically as God's personal mail to us. It's the active part of Scripture. All of Scripture is living, spirit, blood, and water. But the blood part is active today. As soon as we're taken at the rapture, the Pauline epistles will no longer be active for anyone on this planet. Elijah is going to teach them kingdom doctrine. He's going to save them by gospel of the kingdom. And the four gospels in Hebrews to Revelation is what's going to be living and active for them. That's important to get straight. So God chooses the time for each of his sons to see his wisdom. Click on this link. You see the link there? Read the definition of mysterion very carefully. Because the word mystery doesn't have anything to do with being mysterious. Like the English word says. It has to do with what's hidden and then revealed. What was hidden in God and then God himself reveals it. That's what the ministry of the Apostle Paul is all about. Things that were hidden, that's why he uses the term, this term right here, 20 times in his 13 epistles. You take the letters of Peter, John, James, They don't use the word one time because they're sharing the fulfillment of prophecy. The Old Testament, New Testament, Spirit and water, they have that down really good. What's inside of the Pauline epistles, they don't get it at all. Peter calls it the wisdom given him. That the untaught and unstable distort to their own destruction. My apologies. I'm having a little indigestion or something. So which for the few is sooner and for the many is later in the timeline. So some of us are able to see these things today. Blessed is anybody that's able to see it on the earth or in heaven to the end of the ages. But more blessed are those of us that are walking around on the earth in this evil age under this veil of darkness, and we're able to see it and share it with others for whom Christ died. The biggest heavenly rewards are for these things that I'm talking about right here. God's hidden wisdom, there's nothing more valuable in this universe, in the universe beyond that encases this universe, or in the infinite realm than God's wisdom. God's own wisdom. And that's what God's word is sharing with us if you have the eyes to see it. Once you see the pattern, I'm telling you, it's a life-changing, it really is a life-changing thing. But when you read the definition, thing to realize, there was a time for God to reveal these things to Paul through Christ, revelation of Jesus Christ. That's how our gospel was given to Paul. Galatians 1, start at verse 11. Revelation of Jesus Christ. And he goes on about revelations. These are things that nobody knows about until it's revealed through his ministry. Doesn't make Paul any greater than anybody else. No, it doesn't make him greater than Lord God or anything like that. It just makes him the steward through whom God is dispensing his wisdom through his word. There has to be a person like Moses is the steward over Israel. It doesn't make Moses better than the Lord God, does it? No. So some people want to make accusations and point fingers at me for pointing at Paul as if he's something greater than a steward, and he's not. A steward is only a slave that's placed above the other slaves. That's all he is. And he calls himself a bondservant in opening up many of his epistles, because that's exactly what he is, a slave, just like you and me. So look at the definition, and it's dissected in my book, almost word for word, word by word, I should say. Therefore, the story of Elijah and the widowed woman and her son teaches different things to members of different dispensations depending on their level of spiritual development, which is even the case for Christ's body members, having fleshy members and mature members making up the body of Christ. Fleshy members, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, start at 1, and go backwards to 1 Corinthians 2 and start at 6. Paul talks about the mature in God's wisdom that's hidden. 1 Corinthians 2, start at 6. And then right off the bat in chapter 3 to the fleshy Corinthians, he talks about those that are babes that are fleshy. So there's a spectrum. Some of you guys are on the lower end of the spectrum. And Gary's going to ask me down in the question and answer section about that too. Really after my own heart there, Gary, with the three emails you sent me this week. Okay, so the story of Elijah, the widowed. Okay, so yeah, I already gave you this part right here. Some of us are going to see it now. Some of us just aren't. It's God's choice. Is the way that works. Doesn't have to do with being smarter or anything like that. It's a spiritual thing. God puts his hand on this son and says, boom, now it's time for you to see it. Sometimes this is because of your prayer life. This can't tell you how many times that I stood in front of something I wanted to see. To see the truth of the three witnesses took 3 days after, I don't know, about almost a decade of kind of seeing it. But in that, when I mentioned Dr. Clifford Denton, the Tishri guy, those 3 days, it took standing before his throne 3 days and like pleading, God, I want to see this. I want to see this. I'm not doing another thing till you let me see this. And then God gives it to you. So you got to be persistent. You stand in front of his throne. Yeah, I'm still here. Yeah, I'm still here. I really want to see this. Then eventually God looks down. He says, okay, son, he puts his hand on you and then you can see it. That's the way it works. So the more persistent we are, the more that God's going to show us. So the story of Elijah, the widowed woman, and her son is not necessarily a water, blood, spirit. Is not necessarily a witness of the story itself, is what I'm saying. The story, you see, is not necessarily a witness of water, blood, or spirit. But the elements of the story include various spirit witnesses like Elijah and the oil. Elijah and the oil are connected. They're both testifying about one another because they're both spirit witnesses. They're actually testifying about all the other spirit witnesses too. So if you take the testimony of all the spirit witnesses of the Bible, you realize what each is saying, they're all speaking to you at the same time. Angel song is what starts bubbling up. So then the blood witnesses, the sun and the endless supply of bread, the water in the bowl, and the woman, they're helpers, like Eve's the helper, like the Holy Spirit's the helper. All water witnesses, vehicles of locomotion, helpers. So we listen to the testimony of each spirit, blood, and water witness in the realization that each witness testifies about the other witnesses in the mystery set and all the other witnesses, testifying together as angel song rising from God's living word. That is a great thing. It comes from your heart. Having the thinking with your heart instead of what's between your ears. Thinking what's in your heart. Having the mind of Christ is thinking with your heart. It's the focus of your attention, your mind's eye. Rather than reasoning things out logically in your mind, is reasoning things out spiritually in your heart. That's where it's at. That's the difference. Right there. So that's the end of the first part. And then this is the second part after Gary's reply. So he says, now Gary writes me back. He says, Terral, in your reply, in answering the questions regarding Elijah and the widow in 1 Kings, you wrote, there is no kingdom, there's no kingdom of grace, no age of grace either. And Gary, I felt like I offended you a little bit, and my apologies if I did. My specialty is sound doctrine. Whether you're a kingdom disciple, whether you're a member of Christ's body, or you're a son of Israel. Getting the doctrine straight, getting them rightly divided, cut away from each other, right, seeing those three separate dispensations, living under different house rules, knowing the rules, okay, and you don't mix them together. That's very important. Or you create a body of information, of interpretations that God never sent to anybody. There's no kingdom of grace. There's no kingdom of grace or no age of grace either. And so my question, I was referring to the time period between the time of Saul was met on the road to Damascus by Jesus and the rapture of the church. Question, what is the proper name to use for that period? So my apologies again that I was confused. Yeah, my apologies. My focus was on Elijah and the widow and the child. So the three witness aspects of that was what was shining through. And then, because the mention of Paul came at the end, I didn't, with the sentences, then that's, so now with the second, after you send me this, your clarifying statements, it helps me to answer you better. So what's the proper name for the period? That's what he's asking. We're talking about this period that encases the dispensation of God's grace, because a dispensation is not a time or an epoch. It's a household. Here's the right answer. There is no biblical term or phrase to describe this mystery time. It's right here. See it? See this mystery time that's right here? There is no term or phrase to describe this mystery time that none of the Old Testament prophets were allowed to see. Paul describes the dispensation of God's grace that refers to the body of Christ church as a separate household that many like to characterize as, or so it seems, as the age of grace. A lot of dispies really like doing that. This should be the. I'm going to try underneath this mystery diagram. They is the. I'm trying to remember to fix that. The key for getting this right comes from a proper understanding of chronos, translated most frequently as times, like we see in Acts 1, 6 through 7. Okay, I just had to pause a minute and go fix that. When I get a little something off there, it bothers me. So it is fixed in the, it still reads this way here, but it is, it will be fixed in the final. Okay, so the key for getting this right comes from a proper understanding of chronos, translated most frequently as times, like we see in Acts 1, 6 through 7, in Christ's response to the question. So that when they therefore were come together, this is right at the beginning of Acts, six verses in. They asked the Lord, "Wilt thou?" And I use the King James. I was using the King James here. It's a little bit off. "Wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel?" And he said to them, "It is not for you to know the times, Chronos, or the seasons, which the Father has put in his own authority." Paul uses the term. Uses a term using the same root word in addressing the Thessalonians. I say it that way because some people think that Chronos is actually the word. It's the root words. When you're going through the concordances, you're looking at the uses of the roots, not the particular. There's many, many more words in used in the Bible than this shows up in Strong's, because they're just showing you the roots. Okay, so. This is what Paul writes. He says, "But of the times and seasons," we are not talking about a season here. We're talking about a time. "Brethren, you have no need of that I write to you, for you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so come like the thief in the night." I'm so used to the New American Standard. So, see this time right here? This time and epochs. Talking about the day of the Lord, the same thing that Christ is talking about. It's not for you to know the time nor the epochs. Same exact thing that he's talking about in Acts 2, and it's connected to the restoration of the kingdom to Israel backed by Christ, Acts 1, 6, and 7. But it's the time, you see. So the larger picture sees us living in the same evil age, spanning Genesis 1, 2 through Revelation 20, 15. This is an important, very important paragraph in this newsletter and in this opening presentation. Defined by the primary moral characteristic, just look at the definition of age that's misused by many people. It's the moral characteristic that defines the age, and it's the darkness, like the evil forces of this darkness. You see, that fell in Genesis 1:2. That defines the age. Our age, there were perfect ages before Genesis 1:2. We are living in the same evil age since the darkness fell in Genesis 1:2. The darkness, evil forces of this darkness are still overshadowing and running things from heaven. The God of this world is a bad guy. His sons are up there sitting in heavenly places right now. We're going to occupy those heavenly seats when they're chained to start the day of the Lord. That's how we help Elijah. Elijah can't come and restore anything today. Satan's minions are still in heaven. When they're chained, boom, we're sitting in those heavenly places. That's what God made us for. The only way that we would be worthy to sit in those heavenly places and do things the right way is because God makes us worthy. He chooses us and he says, boom, you're it. You're it. You're it. He's gathering like his football team. And we're it. Peter, John, and James, they're like two herds of goats, if you will, from the Old Testament story. Then Peter, John, and James, they're the herd that's on the sea of glass, and we're the herd that's in the lamb. That's rulers and kings. We judge the world and the angels. Peter, John, and James are the ones that bring them to us one at a time. All the citizens of heaven come before us. Even Peter, John, and James do. And we judge the world, the man, and the angel half simultaneously because they are the same thing. And we're only worthy to do that because our angel half and our man half are already reconnected. Okay? So the moral characteristic, the darkness, this darkness that fell in Genesis 1:2. Consider that the day of the Lord really began when Elijah stepped through the second veil to begin fulfilling the Old Testament prophecy. That's why it says, "For the prophets and the law prophesied until," that's right, John the Baptist, pardon me. Only the few, like Peter, John, and James, were chosen, and the rest were hardened due to Israel's transgression. causing God to put the kingdom dispensation and the day of the Lord on the back burner. So you see, this mystery time is parenthetical to the day of the Lord that already started. It's just God put it on the back burner and said, okay, Mr. Mystery Time, here you go. This is where I'm going to make my mystery body of Christ. This is what the devil never saw, because they had seen it. They would have never crucified Christ, because that was sowing their own destruction. God tricked them. That's the great part of all this. It makes me smile. Just think about Satan. We're visiting Satan in the lake of fire. Satan in the lake of fire. You know who Satan in the lake of fire reminds me of? Well, actually, you're looking at his three witnesses. They're the devil, the beast, and the false prophet. But when you go to see the devil in the lake of fire, you visit him. You come after you go visit him, you come and tell me in heaven if he doesn't remind you of Mr. Burns on The Simpsons. Just tell me if he doesn't remind you. Got kind of a scrawny neck, got kind of oversized head a little bit, and he's ugly as sin. He's not anything to look at. When you look at Satan, at the devil, I should say, because Satan in God's infinite realm, that's the devil, the beast, and the false prophet. Those three witnesses are Satan in the infinite realm. Just like the Word is the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Spirit, blood, and water. Same thing for Satan. Same thing for all of us that are here. Okay? So, I mean, seriously, future, looking forward to it. You coming back and saying, you know what? That guy looks just like George Burns from, he's disgusting. Okay? He's pathetic. He really is. The reason he works in the dark is because he's, when he comes out in the light, he's not very much to look at. So, only the few chosen, Peter, John, and James, and the rest were hardened due to Israel's transgression, causing God to put it on the back burner. The water witness kingdom dispensation household that was called first to the gospel of kingdom came first to start the four gospels. But then that was made last, put behind the blood witnesses, part of God's purpose for the ages, and the whole purpose of God. This happens in every single case. The water witness comes out first. Just imagine, this is the type that'll help you. You have the Word. First thing that comes out of the Word is, what do you think it is? It ain't the Son. He doesn't exist. First thing that comes out is the Helper, the Holy Spirit. The water witness comes out the side, just like Eve in Genesis 2, 18 through 20. Put into a sleep, boom, Eve comes out the side. The water witness comes out first. First thing. But then the power from on high, this is Luke 1:35, the power from on high overshadows the Holy Spirit. That's the Father, Spirit witness. Overshadows the water witness. That's like Adam and going into Eve. Same thing. And the Holy Child is called the Son of God. He's the only begotten Son of God. Only begotten Son. Because the Spirit on high and the Holy Spirit commingled together, just like Genesis 1, 6 through 8. That water's above the firmament, the water's below the firmament. The firmament's called heaven. Heaven was begotten. It's a begotten realm. Okay? Just like your soul is begotten by the overlapping of your spirit and your physical body. The soul is a begotten aspect. Just like the Son's begotten. Okay? So for me, God divides times from times within this evil age using the inbound black star that is about to cause the destruction of 1 Thessalonians 5. So the kingdom dispensation can begin again during the upcoming day of the Lord. After all, even the lifespans of man changed with the coming black star in the days of Noah, 1,000 years to 120. And then again, when the black star came in the days of Moses, 120 down to 70, which may be a clue as to what will happen once the black star comes and then leaves the inner solar system. Therefore, this current 2,000-year mystery time, never seen by any of the prophets, is parenthetical to the day of the Lord that already started in the days of the four Gospels. It started with John the Baptist. So then, the next question. What is the proper name that you use for the true church of the body of Christ to be raptured? Not including the denominational churches. You know, the denominational churches are raptured too. They're just raptured to the bad place. For the mystery of Christ, our rapture is part of and sub-part of the mystery of Christ. We're baptized into his body. That's one aspect of it. So, and we're seated with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, Ephesians 2, start 4. But whenever Paul teaches us that, he's teaching us also the antithesis doctrine for the mystery of iniquity. Just look at the mystery of Christ and the mystery of the Antichrist as the mystery of Christ and the mystery of iniquity. When Paul teaches you about us being baptized into Christ, the members of the body of the Antichrist are baptized too. Those are going into the body of the Antichrist. We're going to the body of Christ. The body of the Antichrist is 12 times bigger than the body of Christ. It's big and hairy. It's kind of like an Esau-Jacob thing. So, we are called the body of Christ. That's it. It's really that simple. That's what we're called by Paul in describing how evangelists, pastors, and teachers build up the body of Christ in maturity. Ephesians 4:11-15. Which is a reference to our mystery church as separate dispensation from Israel of the Old Testament and Peter's kingdom bride, the kingdom New Testament. In addition, I've been calling the time period following the rapture to the second coming of Christ in all his glory, the day of the Lord. And that is exactly what it is, too. And I have been saying that Jesus will establish the kingdom of heaven here on earth when he arrives and saves the remnant of Israel that fled to the wilderness. And this is where we are going to disagree. And this is one of the reasons I cannot be called a dispensationalist, because this is what high percentage of the dispies believe. That many, many people believe that Jesus is coming to set up a kingdom. But is that what Jesus said? Is that what Scripture says? Generally, they're mistranslating a couple of words in Revelation chapter 20, verse 4. We've covered that in previous lessons. So Christ's kingdom is heaven, and earth is his footstool. It's important that you realize Jesus Christ is the Lord God of the Old Testament, who is the Lamb of God. The Lamb of God and the Lord of God, synonymous. Same thing. So, the Lamb of God, Adam and Eve in the garden, guess what? They're in heaven. That's Revelation 7. See that throne that's up there? That's the Lamb of God right there. That's the Lord God that made Adam and Eve, kicked them down into the earth. Okay. Then, Christ's kingdom is not of this world, nor even of this realm. Now, this post could have been a lot longer if I go and quote everything. I gave you the verses. Because Pilate's going to ask him. He's going to make statements, and Christ's going to say, my kingdom is not of this world, and it's not even of this realm. So we have a place, like Paul, in his heavenly kingdom. The Lord will rescue me from every evil deed and will bring me safely to his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Paul's going there. Timothy's going there. I'm going there. You're going there. You obeyed our gospel. That's the deal. Whenever you're reading about that we're caught up to be taken away, what does it say? It says, then we're going to forever be with him. We're not coming back to earth ruling any earthly throne either. God made a man for that. So we have citizenship in heaven, in his heavenly kingdom. Now, I usually don't use question marks in my presentations. I'm trying to open up a little air here. When Christ is revealed in glory, that's in Matthew 24, then we also return with him in glory. Many people fail to make that connection, Colossians 3, 4. Christ is going to be revealed in great glory at the end of the age. We're going to be coming with him at the end of the age. So read Matthew. Highly recommend those of you who think Christ is coming to set up a kingdom here to read Matthew 24 from 3 down to 31. And then go to Matthew 25 and go 31 to 46. Highly recommend that. Because when you read it carefully, you're going to see the Son of Man coming with his holy ones. That's us. To realize that we're part of the assembly. There are others that are coming with us that I'm going to mention here in a minute. To realize that we return with Christ at the end of the age in Matthew 24. And the passage takes you straight to the judgment of Revelation 20, verse 11. Just read the passage. Christ comes, boom. Battle of Armageddon, boom. Bad guys, devil, beast, false prophet, all thrown in the lake of fire. Dead raised, everybody judged. Death, all done, finished. Death, Hades, thrown in the lake of fire, don't need him anymore. New heaven and new earth. There's no time from the Son of Man returning and us with him to the setting up of any kingdom in between that period and the judgment. Just read the passage. There's no gap there. So, here's the diagram. The day of the Lord has 1,000 years. This is actually 3,600 years. That's a phrase, Greek euphemism, meaning so long as it takes. Those cut off, this is from Revelation 24. This Greek term is actually, this is the root word. This is a long Greek term using with this root. And it's mistranslated beheaded. It's the only time this word is used in the Bible, so there's no other comparison to it. But it's not what it means. It doesn't mean you see this right here? Early rains bride. You see this right here? Cut off. That is the correct translation of the word. Cut off. That Peter, John, and James, their kingdom church was cut off because of Israel's disobedience. They were saved. They're going to be raised with us at the first resurrection. We're raised. Peter, John, and James are raised. Everybody that obeyed the gospel of the kingdom, they're the early rains bride. They're going to be on that sea of glass, serving before us as members of the Lamb's body. When you're reading about it in Revelation, you tell me if you think they're in heaven or if you think they're on the earth. They're ruling with the Lamb, all right, in heaven for the whole 1,000 years, which is really 3,600. So here we're taken, we're judged, 2 Corinthians 5:10. We're put in those heavenly seats according to our pecking order. Some of us have great, giant, we're big, big crowns, scepters, power, jewels, giant crowns. All kinds of jewels, glistening and everything. Some of us only have one little brass ring on our finger. There's a pecking order, like chickens, kind of. But we're going to be put in our seats up there of importance based on that pecking order. It's up there. We're going to help Elijah restore all things on earth as it is in heaven. So, quite a bit down here. And we're talking about this cutoff. Peter, John, and James were cut off. That's the ones that they're talking about being beheaded. People get that into their minds as those being beheaded during the Great Tribulation. That's not what this is talking about. This is talking about Peter, John, and James, those that are raised with us to start the day of the Lord. When you're reading Revelation, you get the retelling of the same story over and over and over again from different perspectives. So, Peter, John, and James, they're raised with us at the first resurrection. Who rule with us, who rule with the Lamb before his throne. There they are, right there. And they're on the sea of glass. So you can see them right here. See the body of Moses? They're on the sea of glass that's right here. On the opposite side of us, they can't see it. But we know we're members of the Lamb. Body of Elijah's on the opposite side. This is these guys' angel halves. Jacob's ladder is restored in the new kingdom. See, this is a new heaven, the new earth. David's on the earth doing what the Lamb's doing in heaven. And the Lamb is here in the earth. Remember, this is earth of Genesis 1:1. Doing the same things that God's doing in the heaven of Genesis 1:1. On earth as it is in heaven. On earth as it is in heaven. It's really a magnificent thing when you can see this. And then you begin to realize, what's the mystery of Christ? What's God's mystery? All detailed in my book, The Mystery Explained. So David rules as prince during the day of the Lord. Just go check it out. That's what it says. And restored as the king, he's restored again. He's prince here, and he's king here. And he's forever here because this forever here is in the new earth of Revelation 21:1. David, the king, the Messiah, is cut off. Daniel 9, start at 24. The abomination of desolation is set up. 62nd week. That's 8 times 7, 56 years from the end of the age. That's going to happen. You know why he's going to be killed? Part of the reason? We have to reproduce what happened in the infinite realm when Satan murdered Adam, which means the dragon, the devil, the beast, and the false prophet, all incarnate on the earth as men, all have to play a role in it. Three witnesses that testifying for Satan have to murder the prince. But he is killed with 56 years to go towards the end, from the end of the age, but before the black star comes the next time, so that he can be brought back again as one of the two witnesses of Revelation 11. I know how that sounds, but that's the truth. The powers that those two witnesses have are the same powers of Adam and Eve, the same powers that David's going to have sitting on the throne. He's going to be, the people are going to be bringing him gifts, and he's going to be sending rain, just like Elijah does. And when Elijah says, don't rain, don't rain. Same thing with David. He's going to have all those powers because it's not Elijah's powers. It's the powers of the original Adam and Eve in the garden. It's the powers of the cultivators of the land. You have those three witnesses and their powers, those two witnesses, I should say, and the powers that are testifying about Adam and Eve. People want to make them into Moses and Elijah, when Moses and Elijah are Adam and Eve too. It's the way that it is. So God's wisdom is in plain sight, right in front of you, once you recognize the pattern in the three witnesses. Okay, so that's what I basically said right here in my lengthy commentary there. Then, I don't know if there is a name for the, pardon me, if there's a name for the church of the kingdom, or if it's even correct to call it that. Am I correct in using the term the day of the Lord? And is there a term for the church of the kingdom of God? So when you say in the kingdom of God, now I realize what you're saying. You're talking about Peter's kingdom bride who are saved under the gospel of the kingdom. So please correct me if I'm in error. Forgive me for my semantics. Then I'm going to say that, you, hey, Gary, you're doing really fine. You see things as well as most, as well as that the, can see the three witnesses. When you first get exposed to it, it's kind of hard. It's like recognizing a figure coming in the distance, and you kind of has familiar features, but you can't tell quite who it is. And then as it gets closer and closer, then all of a sudden, so these things are getting closer and closer to you, and you're seeing more things than the average bear or park ranger. Trust me on that. There's never any reason to say, oh, forgive me for this or that. No, no, no. That's not the way that it works. You never have to do that. I felt that I was offending you a little bit because people can be sensitive about their beliefs and faith and, things like that. It can be very, very sensitive to people. The thing to realize here is that we are soldiers. That we have mud on our brow. We have mud in our boots. And we're in a battle fighting over the souls of men right now. And we get the doctrine right. That's the most important. The minister that preaches sound doctrine is almost like a doctor fixing the spiritual body. And so it's about it's getting it right. More important than anything else. It's not about our personal whatever. It's not about those things. So it's about opening the door and helping people see the light. And sometimes you guys do that, and the way you're asking questions, you send me to do my research, and then I come back seeing things better than whenever I first went before. So we're all learning as we go. The part for me is the reason that I see these things, you have to see, believe me, this diagram was drawn in 2004, 15 years ago. And in order to draw diagrams like this that start off as just two little overlapping circles, then you have to be in God's spirit. God is the one who's going to show you these things. This is God's stuff. I didn't invent this stuff. And my apologies of referring to it as stuff. Seems to diminish it, but it doesn't. These are God's things, though. And he is revealing them, his wisdom, through his three witnesses. It's his things. So why God picked me to see this from the time I was like 18 years old and then brought me up, and he gave me another little part. And then I went on the wandering for 3 years because I was so mad at God I couldn't stand it over the mystery of iniquity. I couldn't understand it, but it was my immaturity. I was like the one that, like Gary's trying to say with me. Pardon me, my voice is about to go. Saying, Lord God, forgive me, because I didn't understand about the mystery of iniquity. The thing that was making me angry is that God was showing me these things, and I would show it to other people. They couldn't see it. God was blinding them from seeing it. The polluting influence. 2 Thessalonians 2, starts 7. And verse 10, God is the one that sends the deluding influence. Isn't the devil sending it? God is sending it. And if God sends it, the deluding influence on somebody, they're deluded indeed. There's nothing you can do to help them. It's impossible. They cannot see these things. So it was making me angry that God gave me these beautiful jewels, these nuggets, these gold, this gold, silver, and all this good stuff. And I'm the only one that could see it. That's the way it was. Imagine back in the 70s and the 80s. Then when the internet came around, because I was debating with, that's how I met Dr. Clifford Denton, through his Tishri newsletter thing, and got a hold of one, and then got the address and started writing him. There wasn't an internet yet. And then whenever the internet came, God was showing me these three witnesses, spirit, blood, and water. What do you think I'm doing every Saturday morning? Getting up, turning on the computer when I had one, and then looking for somebody who had already seen these things before, because I wanted to learn it faster than God was showing it to me. And there was nobody else that was had anything that was like this. So anyway, you're doing fine. And because you see this three witnesses, spirit, blood, and water. Some people can't even see that far. Peter's Kingdom Church is a characterization of the assembly that Jesus Christ calls my church. Again, this would be really, really, really long if I quoted all these for you. In combination with passing the keys to the kingdom, remember he says, talks about Peter, he's the little rock, and the big rock is the truth that he's the Son of God. And then he says that he's going to give Peter the keys of the kingdom. You see, that's the kingdom part. And he calls it my church. That's what makes it a kingdom church. So the gospel of the grace of God, quote unquote, that's the phrase that Paul uses through the Holy Spirit in Acts 2, verse 24. And that's what I call it, the gospel of the grace of God. You call it the word of the cross from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, 17, 18. Word of the cross or the gospel of the grace of God. Love to use those. You know, the gospel of the kingdom is the gospel of the kingdom. I'm not making it up. That's the exact phrase. Matthew 4:23, 9:35, 24:14, and it's characterized in Acts 8:12 as the good news concerning the kingdom of God. But that's God's phrase used in his word that I am quoting. So this, when I call it the kingdom church, it's not in the Bible. But the word Bible is not in the Bible either, and we use it every day. You see what I mean? So there are more accurate characterizations, I would say. And since the keys of the kingdom are being passed and Christ calls it my church, that's the kingdom church. Since it's the gospel, the kingdom is saving them and they're inheriting the kingdom of heaven, then it's the kingdom church to me. Peter's kingdom bride is what I call it because John the Baptist calls them the bride, John 3:29. Numpy. Paul never uses the word once in any of his epistles. We're the body of Christ. That's a big difference. So he calls it my church in combination with the keys of the kingdom. And you're going to note that things are bound in the earth. Things bound in the earth have been bound in heaven, which follows the on earth as it is in heaven scenario. See how we're getting back to that. Carried throughout Christ's kingdom doctrine teachings, like Matthew 6:10. The man placed on earth to do these things that the Lord God is doing in heaven is Adam from Genesis 2:7. Placed in human skins, we know as Adam, as Abraham, Joshua, David, John the Baptist, the prophet of Acts 3, who's Elijah, and one of the two witnesses of Revelation 11, and there are others. Adam is one of the two olive trees. That's what I was, see, you notice how this is kind of the one side of the bread, and the other side of the bread was at the top. That's kind of the point of that. So that's the opening that I want to share with you. It took a while to get through it, but a lot of golden nuggets in there for those that, for the miners among us that are going to dig a little bit. So this is the coronavirus update that is part of this newsletter. This could easily be signs of the times, the pestilence that we're talking about. This if you're just a subscriber, a YouTube subscriber to this channel, then you're going to want to check out the Black Star channel. I'm covering it more there and trying to give more of God's wisdom here, but there's no way that this newsletter can be anywhere near accurate for our time. just before we're being taken, without including what's happening right here. This is what's on the mind of everybody. The world is changing because of this. This was written by Stephanie, written to me by Stephanie. God bless you, Stephanie. Very, very nice lady. And thank you for writing, for your support. Please write me at, see, whenever you're a subscriber, and I'm not talking about a YouTube subscriber, I'm talking about a newsletter subscriber. Whenever you go to the website right here, and you click on one of these buttons right here, right? These four buttons, these are the four newsletter programs. Being a subscriber to one of these programs is what allows you the opportunity to benefit from this astounding deal. 6 liters, 10 parts per million of Doug's Nano Silver for only $50. That includes shipping anywhere inside the United States. It's over $600 of value. So anyway, these are the newsletter programs. The one for this mystery report is right here. And, you know, it's kind of amazing to me. I want to mention it right here. I'm going to mention again in the Black Star report that there are people that are out there that are going up and clicking on this button without being a subscriber, right? And it says all Terral03.com newsletter subscribers. How much clearer do we have to be here? I'm not kidding you. There's at least a dozen people on the Nano Silver list at the very bottom that continue to be pushed down, down, down. Other people are getting in front of them because they're not supporters or they're not subscribers. You do not have a subscription. You do not have a subscription status the day that you started supporting. If you don't have that, that's one of the things that Doug insists on. He's been a supporter since 2016. Before any of this stuff ever started, before there was even a survival group program, before, right? And so, this is an astounding deal that he's doing here. Doug's doing a whole lot of work. And I'm doing a whole lot of work too, right? And so, this is like the best deal you're ever going to find anywhere in our time for the threats that are coming, like a herd of freaking buffalo or something that's going to try to trample you over. And it's not necessarily going to be the bug. It's going to be what the government does because of the bug, like what's going on and people being locked in their houses in China. Wait till this gets out of control here and wait till it mutates. Something nobody's... I'm listening when I'm not making these videos. Listen, you guys, there's the news is running in the background. I'm flipping because I want to hear what the left says and what the right says. And the words they're using is going into the supercomputer. And they are not mentioning the fact this thing is going to mutate. And it's going to mutate in different ways, in different reservoirs, and different carriers. Okay, so enough of that. So, yeah, she subscribed. And she is going to be able to join us at the $50 level. And that's $50 per year. That's $4 a month. Then that gives you the ability, you're going to get a different notification email from a newsletter subscriber. That's only $2 a month. That notification email gives you the chat room, where to go to register, how to join us on Tuesday nights. So Stephanie can be there tonight. You can come up, raise your hand. And then, you know, you can put me on the spot. If you think, if generally every question that you're asking me, I've heard it all before, pretty much 30,000 posts at countering biblical contradictions. You may be able to get it from the Wayback Machine, because they took the site down. 30,000 of my posts went down, answering every conceivable biblical contradiction. Well, people think they're contradictions, but there are none in the Bible, if you interpret it properly. So anyway, two important questions. How does the nano silver help protect us? And so the basic information is right here. And similar to sodium borate, then this thing is an inhibitor. It stops the virus from being able to do things. Channel transcript blocking compounds, positive patient outcomes. It inhibits the growth of one-celled organisms by activating the organism's oxygen metabolism enzymes. Destroys the membranes, stopping replication of the DNA. Very similar to the way sodium borate works as an antifungal, as nanosilver's antifungal, natural. Stuff's like a miracle. As the lady said, writing to Doug, in the conversation, she was writing me, and something went with the order. The one of the bottles froze or something. Doug fixed it magnificently right away, by the way. But one of the little statements she made is this stuff's like gold, and it really is. The people that are taking advantage of this program, of this offer that Doug's making, then if they have abscess tooth, they have bacterial infection like I did in my jaw, guess what? It's going to kill it. If you have a range of contagions that you're carrying around, you have a nagging something or other, like, well, I don't want to mention any names, get in trouble. Doug's going to get mad at me. Rightfully so. Because you have to be careful with the claims you make. This thing is it's a supplement. It's a dietary supplement to help build your immune system. Let's just put it that way. Okay, so there are reasons why it works, and there's reasons why it works better than the colloidal silver. So then she says, my understanding is bot sprays need metals in their body to interact, and we are to try to, that's chelate them as much as possible. I've always heard that silver has no place or benefit in the body, but I'm clearly interested in your opinion. And my response is many of the healthcare professionals doing research in nano silver area. See, the nano in anything is growing right now, all around us. Nano, everything. Nano silver is just part of it. So they're going to disagree with you, and just click on this. Huffington Post, nine silver benefits and uses backed up by science. Nine of them. They've already figured out. You notice that nobody's going to mention nano silver on any of these TV shows. They're going to talk about antivirals, but that's going to be the concoction that the pharmaceutical concoction, not this natural type remedy. The way that silver itself in these minute doses are able 10 parts per million, that when it gets in there, it just messes the bug up. And the beauty about this is that it's going to act on the novel virus, and the one they're not telling you about are the multiple mutated versions that are going to come from this bug. So this is only the beginning of it. You're only dealing with the novel. Just wait till this thing grows teeth. I'm watching for the spike all the time. This thing is going to mutate for sure. Don't know if it's going to be in the USA. If it does, I would expect it's going to be out west. Remember that if you follow my reports, California is going to have the most cases for sure. And then on the East Coast, it's going to breed out of the Northeast, out of New York. That's what's going to happen. That's where you have high concentrations of areas of people that are going in back and forth from the Orient. That's what got it started. So then she wants to know when is the catastrophic event going to happen, and that's the $64,000 question. And the answer is, since the black star is slowing down, it has a magnetic repulsion relationship with the sun. These are the articles that explain it. Then we know when it's going to happen. We know the month that it's going to happen. We almost know the day that it's going to happen. There are a lot of things that we know. And you see these dates? If it happens this year, it's going to be on the 17th, or we're going to have another crossing event, like we did all these other times. All these events were predicted. We predicted this quake right here to within half a day. We predicted Fukushima within 4 days, Guerrero within 2 days. This one here, we're going to this we're going to hit this one. But this could be the geological pole shift. This could be the elite fail-safe plan we're looking at. We could be looking at the rapture that's coming. I'm not going to give a day or I'm not going to give any times or anything like that. But it's going to be just before the destruction. When Paul writes to the Thessalonians in the fifth chapter, that's where destruction happens. The end of the fourth chapter is where we're taken, you see. So we're given kind of a chronology there. The earth changes are the birth pangs. So we know when it's going to come because we know it came from Gemini, and we know that it's going to reach perihelion between the sun and Sagittarius. There are things we know, but if you don't know how much more the thing's going to slow down, you don't know when it's going to get here. That's just a simple mathematical fact. Okay, so magnetic repulsion relationship. We have to be prepared for every May moving forward. So we know the elite will implement their fail-safe plan that will include the release of a biological contagion. I've been saying that for years, and here we are in the middle of it right now. Well, that's the start of it. Medical martial laws are likely what's going to happen. The keywords you're going to listen for are travel restrictions. Just listening. You're listening for mutation. You're listening for travel restrictions because they're already using this. Started yesterday. the pattern in their speech is changing, and it's going to continue to change. I'm watching the 17th of each month through May 17th, April 17th, March 17th coming up. And you're going to see changes in the way, the choices of terms they're using. They give themselves away by the things they say and the things they never say. There's particular keywords that I'm looking for that I do not expect them to say. One of those keywords for this moment is mutation. That because this bug is just the herald strain. This is just the novel strain. This is the first part. It's the mutated part. And they're chasing it with a vaccine that's not going to be ready for a year. And when it mutates, what they're doing now is not going to matter. Yeah, okay, it's going to work against the novel strain. But what about the bad strain? They're going to be chasing this bug. It's going to be slipping through their fingers the whole time. And the chances are the House of Rothschild already has the antidote for it. I don't know if they have it for the mutated strain or whether they can predict if this thing's artificial intelligence assisted, which it could be. That's one thing. And if this is the first half of a binary weapon, that could be the thing too. And the AI could assist in the secondary part of the binary weapon. So there's a lot of different what ifs in these scenarios. Some of them that you're never going to hear on the TV. This happens to be one of my areas of expertise because of the research done for 2 years back in 2009 and 10, and listening to Dr. Ott, Dr. Bill Deagle, and a range of experts in the area that helped me to pick myself up by the bootstraps and understand more about the contagion. It was necessary to understand the elite failsafe plan, the different components of it. So that's what's being executed. And AI is running real-world simulations into the future for identifying the threats. That's what the nanobots are about. That's what chemtrailing is about. The elite are doing this to identify the people that are the threats that are going to create havoc for the underground Ark City program. That's it. Pretty simple. So, Google Stu Noodles Dead Astronomer Report. It's posted at Planet X News. Just Google it, read it. Look at all the astronomers that have been murdered, killed. They're missing. AI singled them out because at some point in the future, in the simulation, they solved the puzzle and they warned the world and the elite's plan failed. AI is there to make sure they don't fail. So, see, the elite plan does not include wiping out the population using nanobots nor the coronavirus contagion. They're using these components as part of a larger plan to keep the sheeple dumbed down and to limit the sheeple mobility. That's what the medical martial law is going to be, the roadblocks. That's why I say listen for travel restrictions. It's going to happen. They're going to be locking up cities here. So if you're in a big city, you just keep on being in a big city until you can't go anywhere. Because that's going to happen. You want to get yourself onto your survival group property on the North American Craton. Because if you're going to be trapped where you're at, the earth changes come, and then what are you going to do? You're not going to be able to go anywhere. That's their plan. So this thing is, see how it's creeping up on us? This is their plan. You're slowly being desensitized by the rehashing of all these things on the media until you're dumbed down and you cannot react. That's what they're trying to do. So, and even AI and the elite are going to use my testimony to desensitize people. So I'm one of their useful, I mean, I didn't sign up for it, to be their associate or be their asset, if you will, not deliberately. But if they can use me as a Planet Xer or a Bible-thumping, you know, idiot or a 9/11 conspiracy theorist, right? All of those things are, you know, why would you ever believe that guy? So the way that things are presented at the website of my scripture work, 9/11 work, and Project Black Star is so that I'm looked upon as like being just a radical, like conspiracy theorist, Bible thumping, you know, Planet Xer, which allows me to be used by them. That makes me useful to them to desensitize people so they don't want to knock me off. It's kind of the way it works. So as long as my reach remains under 1 million per month, I think I'm good. The problem in 2011 and 12, we were doing seven radio shows a week. We were on Clive Lewis's radio show. We were expanding, doing a radio show, averaging one every day, reaching more and more people with a very gifted group of people, so that we did become a threat. Now we've learned from that. So you see, my YouTube channel grows very slowly. Still don't even have 25,000 people yet. You see Dutch Sense and those guys, well, they took his down, but you see people out there with a half a million, you know, 400,000 or half a million suspicious observers in those guys. All right, so I'm just a little teeny, I'm not a threat to anybody. I'm just a little chicken on the totem pole. Allows me to continue giving you guys who can see the light, right? If you can see it, then you can benefit from it. So many people are going to come by and they're not going to see anything. They're just going to say, this guy's nuts. So that kind of works in our favor for us to be used that way. So anyway, the National Guard, the military, they're already being deployed. You see all these deployments that are going overseas to the Middle East, this and that. They want to get our military people away from here because the American military will not go against our people. At least they cannot run the model that says that they're going to for sure 100%. The American people can do those terrible things to the people of the Middle East, and you can bring the Chinese troops over here, the Russian troops over here, and all of a sudden, they're not going to mind doing these things to Americans. That's why they're here. But then, you see, they pit the people against the military and so that they can run to their underground arc cities. Just ahead of the roadblocks, they're going to be running to their underground arc city in Denver. They're around the world. They're all throughout the United States in safe zones. That's going to be their plan. So I'm looking at my time, and I can see already that there may be some connections here with the 5G. My apologies. I have not had time to run all that things down. Dana Ashley has done some, was able to see part of her video on this, but it looks like she's trying to track this down. What I can tell, the oxygen part, the oxygen element, the way that it's interrupted with by the nanosilver, the oxygen, the free ions, that is good. I listened to her commentary, then there's something there. I know that there's something there, but for me, the answer is to get the shield, the nanosilver. And so that you have the opportunity to block, you know, the thing that's coming in, and the mutated version, the 5G, this 5G, the 60 gigahertz frequency that they're using, starves your body of oxygen. It's the oxygen that is the common denominator in all these things, from the nanosilver to the way the bug works, to the 5G waves, the 60 gigahertz waves, and the way that excites. The oxygen, something to do with the oxygen, for sure. I have not been able to draw, for me, like with the scripture, decades it required to be able to draw these conclusions and speak about them the way I do. You're not going to get me out on a limb that's going to break off under me because I'm doing the research first. And with everything that's going on in my one-man band here, now, whenever I say that, there are lots of people that are helping. Don't get me wrong. Look at Doug and his wife, troopers. All right, so there's lots of you guys that are helping me, and these newsletters don't just come together. Look, Stephanie created the opportunity. Gary's creating the opportunity. He's helping to navigate, manipulate the narrative on what's going on here. So this is a group thing. Don't get me wrong. Whenever I say that. But anyway, we're going to try to rush through here. So the report's not 2 hours long. Do you really need to stock up? You should already be stocked up. In my view, you should be a member of the Survivor Group program. You should be on the group Survivor Group list so you get the notification. You should be able to have the email addresses of your fellow survivalists so that you know who else is with you in Arkansas, who else is with you in California, who else is with you in Wisconsin. You can get on the list and you can do things individually. You can do it in groups. You can do it however you want. There's no rules here. I recommend you join Rebecca's group. That's where I'm a member. That's the strongest group that I am aware of the four that we have in the United States. That's the strongest group that I know of in the world, as far as the groups that we've put together, that I put together through this campaign over the years. The masks, please. Don't insult yourself. Masks, these N95 masks. It's like walking around with a, if you ever go fishing, you know, a bass net looks like, has the big old holes. Imagine putting that over your head and you're walking around with it on your head, because the bug is only 5 nanometers wide and it can squeeze through a, did I say 550 nanometers? These masks that they're talking about, N95 masks, they act like they're a great big deal or something. They're made for 0.3 microns. They're going to stop particulates. 0.3 microns, that's 300 nanometers. So you got a 300 nanometer hole and a 50 nanometer wide bug. In other words, they could come in side by side, 6 wide, and still go right through that mask. So don't even worry about the mask. Block. You want the thing, if the thing's in your environment, you want to get it to get inside you with the silver so it kills it. So you know you're not going to be a carrier. You know it's not going to mutate inside of you. You know you're not going to give it to your children. Well, if you're not going to get it from Doug, then get it from somewhere. But I'm telling you, I see the prices that are out there. You're looking at 8 ounces at a time or 16 ounces at a time for 30, 40, 50 bucks when you can get 12 pints for that. He's going to send you a concentrate, 2 little 2-ounce bottles that you put into 3 liters of fluid, 1 bottle into 3 liters of fluid. 2 bottles make you 6 liters. Greatest deal they ever heard of. Okay, so I need to run through this a little quicker. Coronavirus has been spreading in Washington State for more than 6 weeks. No kidding. That's what I've been saying. It's already here. It's already here. You have a gestation period that's longer than 27 days. And it's even longer for some people with different genetic propensities. Pardon me. This is how far we had to go to get down to the news. The 43 supporters now. And this is the supporters that are right here. And yes, Trevor, Trevor's been on the list. And these, you guys are in order here too, the way that you came in. Jeff was the last one to subscribe just, I believe it was this morning. Oh, you guys, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. That's one per day for the Mystery Report program. Appreciate you guys' support very, very much. I hope that you're blessed by this work and that you'll share this video with other people. You know, it's kind of long. It's full of good stuff. Then these people write me and they ask me, well, how do you join chat? And I have survivor group people asking me, how do you join chat? Well, then you have to join the Mystery Report Tutor Chat Program. One way that you can join us in chat, and that's to click on this button right here. This one gets you the newsletters only. You're going to get 57 newsletters because there were 5 in 2019. But this one here, then see Gary, he's one of these premium guys. He pays an extra $2 a month, and he sends me these questions and look at the answers that he's getting, the time that's going to be spent. Same thing with Trevor, same thing with Brian, same thing with Najee. Great supporter of the research. Najee writes me questions. Bells on, man. You guys are really, really helping me. One of the reasons this program was started is because I was getting desperate. These medical bills running over 20 grand. It's difficult to make that up with $25 subscriptions, right? So we had to have another program, or something bad was going to happen. And then, so you guys are coming to support. And then Doug came along, not only fixed my jaw, not only helped me get my mouth right, but then he had the idea. Doug is the one that informed me about nanosilver and its properties and how it's better than colloidal silver and holy mackerels. And then created this opportunity so that, guess what? The kid is back in the game. So greatly, greatly appreciate your support. This is where you guys can write me if you're a non-supporter. Just remember, this is what I was going to say earlier. You have a special email address that you write me at if you are one of these subscribers. It's not this email address. That's where you want to be writing me. That's the email address I work from every morning. You guys are the ones that support me. So as a YouTuber, you can write me here, and I'm going to get there as time permits. So please allow time. And this is the most, I've never been this busy before in my life in doing anything. It's from first thing early in the morning to last night, it was till like 10:30 at night, trying to catch up. So watching Watch silver. This is one of the markers that's going to be passed on one of these 17th days. This thing's going to start rising. Right now, looking at this price, you're real close to being able to get 5 silver eagles for $20. And later in the timeline, it's going to be 1 silver eagle for over $200. So if you have extra resources and paper sitting in stocks or whatever, you might want to think about putting some of it into this small denomination silver. Just saying. Then, so how do we do in chat? That's how you do it. See the answers are for you right here. Answers to commonly. How do you receive the newsletter reports? Those are the two buttons. $2, $4 per month. And some people think that this is $25 per month. And it's just right up here. It says pay by PayPal for yearly subscriptions. I did change that. It's $2 a month. So then a few people they're making their purchases of silver, and then they realize, oh, it's $2 a month. Oh, I got to subscribe. Oh, never mind. Give me a refund. And I'm just laughing to myself, shaking my head, going, okay, you get $600 because math is one of my favorite subjects, straight A's in math. $600 worth of nano silver to protection against what's coming. And you already made the donation, but nope, can't have that misreport newsletter for $2 a month. That means this newsletter is 50 cents. What are you going to get for 50 cents? You can't imagine. But there are a few people that have received refunds. Two orders purchased, $100, full refund, because that's my word with Doug. We're only going to fill orders for newsletter subscribers, period. That's it. That's the rule. So the 12 people on the list eventually, because I'm going to send you like one more notice, and then you're going to get a refund because it's only for supporters. If you can't support the research for $2 a month, you just think about it. Put yourself in Doug's shoes, who's been supporting for 4 years now. That it's not for the whole world. It is for Terral03.com supporters only. Okay, so these are my. I'm not gonna have time to get into this. You guys are going to have to get the newsletter and read it. I'm defending the two churches of the New Testament. This is the thread. This is the guy that's writing, and well, let's just say this is originally what he writes. So he just quotes, and he just says K. That's a comment with a K, I guess, or like okay. So since I quoted this, it's okay. No, quoting scripture means that you follow it with an interpretation. You have to interpret it. Say what it means, because everybody reads the scriptures. All the denominations read the same Bible. They all have their own different interpretations. I'm going to interpret it my way. You're interpreting it your way. Talk about semantics problem. So this is the extent of my time for this week is what I was able to share. I was looking for like a better adversary, just couldn't really find one for my topics that were presented in the board. So the bottom line is, if you think Peter, John, and James are in the same church with Paul, Barnabas, and Titus, then think about Acts 15 and Galatians 2. How come they're having this famous meeting? How come Paul had to go down and submit the gospel? I preach among the Gentiles, Galatians 2, 1 and 2. And then he characterizes it as the gospel to the uncircumcised, and he says it's like Peter's to the circumcised. That's the gospel of the kingdom and the gospel of the grace of God. Two different things. Two different churches, two different gospels. Totally different. The denominations cram them together and make one giant church out of it. And that distorts the wisdom given him to their own destruction. 2 Peter 3, start 14. The disobedience of the church. This is a very, very good Gary again, after my heart, man. Let me see if I can get you guys through this. I'm looking at the time. We're still going to be under 2 hours. Since we are the Church of Grace, the body of Christ, which is that's what we are, gospel of the grace of God, chosen before time began for salvation, and not the gospel of the kingdom, could you clarify what constitutes disobedience by us in the eyes of God the Almighty and Jesus Christ? I see easily that if a member of the kingdom of heaven doesn't do good works, doesn't keep the law, they are disobedient, they can lose their salvation. But I'm unclear as to what I can do or not do that would get me into trouble with the God Almighty and our Lord Jesus Christ. So please explain if my thinking is right or wrong in this matter, and what is disobedience for us, members of Christ's body. Number one, it takes courage to expose yourself and ask questions. If people read the Bible, they think they're experts on it, and then they don't think they have to ask anybody anything because they know everything. So this is the proper attitude. And Gary, like I said, he's ahead of the average bear, and he's asking the questions in precisely the right way, with the right tenor, the right tone, everything. So this is the question. My answer is, once God has chosen us through the gospel, this is right after the mystery of iniquity, by the way, then we are seated with Christ in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus as finished, perfect, complete heavenly hosts. God imputes his righteousness through the faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe, period. From that moment on, our lives are hidden with Christ in God. As is written, therefore, if you have been seated, if you have been raised up with us, let me try again. My mind's a little, well, let's just say it's fluid. It's almost like a rubber band trying to snap sometimes. Therefore, if you have been raised up with us, keep seeking the things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above and not the things that are on the earth. For, and the person that comes to mind to me is Doug and his wife. They're thinking about helping people. They're doing it for the least possible cost. And they're helping just tons of people. And do you know what? Their eyes are fixed on the things above where Christ is, the right hand of God. They have a reward coming to them that is exceptional. And I was the one that was a little more like, Doug, 600, I think you should be getting a little bit more. And nope, that's what it is. So Doug really impressed me with that. So set your mind on things above, not on the things that are on the earth, for you have died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. That's the mystery of Christ. We obey the gospel, then we are baptized into his body on the cross. So when he dies, we die with him. We're in the earth with him 3 days. We are raised again with him, and we ascend with him. We're in his body. We're seated with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that our life is hidden with Christ in God. Guess what? Your life's hidden with Christ in God? That's the definition of eternal security. There's nobody's going to pluck you out of God. God has put you there. You're his beloved son. Whenever God looks at you, he sees his son. That's the mystery of Christ, being baptized into Christ's body. And God, guess what? God loves his only begotten son more than we can imagine. And that is bestowed upon us. We're imputed at God's righteousness is imputed upon us so that we can become the righteousness of God in him. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 16 through 21. Which is a really, really great thing whenever you realize it. So when Christ, who is our life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. That is Matthew 24. At the end of the age. So we're with him to start the day of the Lord, and we're coming back with him at the end of the day of the Lord. The idea that Christ is going to set up an earthly kingdom here, never going to happen. This kingdom is not of his world. He made David for that. This is, blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Quote. From Mark's gospel. And that's what's coming. So while your salvation is 100% secure and your life is hidden with Christ in God, Christ's body members can break fellowship with God by doing the opposite of what Paul teaches these Colossians. Seeking the things of this earth and following the flesh path stunts the Christian spiritual growth, forcing him or her to be one of Paul's fleshy babes. Paul describes the differences between the deeds of the Spirit and flesh in Galatians 5. Read it. So what am I doing wrong? The things of the flesh. What am I doing good? The things of the Spirit. It's really that simple. Where obviously the deeds of the flesh are favorable for earning the greatest heavenly rewards. And Paul writes to these fleshy Corinthians. Then you guys can stop it and read it. So I'm getting concerned about the length of this video. But the wood, hay, straw, these are the bad works. Gold, silver, precious stones, this is what shows up. You're going to put your good works and your bad works too on that altar. When we all approach that altar, we're going to all look the same, like the chickens. all the same plumage, all the same. We're going to all look identical almost. And then we put our things on the altar, and it goes poof. And some of us are going to have beautiful white smoke, beautiful white garment, big crown, big scepter, big jewels. Some of us are going to have little ring on our finger and a sooty garment. You keep running after those earthly things, the soot piles up in your garment. You're going to be on the lower rungs of the totem pole, the pecking order, in the heavenly pyramid where Christ is the capstone. So you eliminate the deeds of the flesh. You magnify the things of the spirit. And that's the trick. Then right here is where the rubber meets the road for answering the question about how following the spirit and seeking the things above are far greater than following the deeds of the flesh. Good spiritual works help yourself to grow in Christ, and helping your brothers and sisters grow in Christ produces good works that are rewarded with gold, precious stones, a big jewel-filled crown, that's a symbol of authority, and a scepter, which is a symbol of power, that include the beautiful white heavenly garment. Okay, bad works of the flesh earn the believer wood, hay, and straw that burns when placed upon the altar to fill the white garment with smoky inclusions that darken the garment, pushing the Son of God down the pecking order. So our brethren who walk by the Spirit with the greatest regularity are earning the highest heavenly rewards. Those following the flesh are inheriting bad rewards, with some earning perhaps a silver ring on one of their fingers. And before I go any further, we're going to be able to go places in heaven. The ones with the magnificent ephod, the chest plate, it's going to have stones on it. Whenever you walk in front, you're walking by one of your brothers, and their chest plate, some of them just astounding. The light shining off the edges of every corner of every stone is telling a story of the great accomplishments. As you're passing them by, you see your different brethren, you can see their accomplishments or their lack of accomplishments. The wood, hay, and the straw you can see too in the smokiness of their garment. We know each other. When we first go to that altar, we all look the same. We turn around, we are all individuals. Big, small, everything in between. Some great, some small. So then Gary says, I easily see that the member of Christ, Kingdom of Heaven who doesn't do good works, they do not get to keep it. Now they can lose their salvation. Says, that's right. They can be killed. They can die instantly for betraying the Holy Spirit. So he's unclear on what we can do or not do that would get you in trouble with God and the Almighty. So I say first, there is nothing you can do to impact your relationship with Jesus Christ either way. That's important to realize. Keep in mind that Christ is our intercessor. Romans 8:34. That's he intercedes for us, which means make petition for. He's the one mediator, that's Christ Jesus, between God and men. Both the terms, intercessor and mediator, just look at the middle. And the interceding is someone that comes in between, you see? So both point to someone standing between any defendant and the judge, who in this case is the Almighty, Almighty God. He's the judge. Christ would be the first person to stand for in your defense, offering petition to God on your behalf. Then God has your best interests at heart and chastens the son he loves, while letting the devil's disobedient children get away with murder in this life, so they burn to the ages of the ages in the lake of fire. Staying in good fellowship with God means following the Spirit and putting aside the deeds of the flesh, with eyes focused on the things above in heaven. Temptation and deeds of the flesh put spiritual roadblocks that will find the Son of God having to learn the same lessons repeatedly while making little spiritual progress. Do you ever get that feeling? You succumb to the flesh, and then you're learning the same lesson you already learned. You're going, man, I just feel like I'm going in circles. I'm not going up the mountain at all. I'm on this plateau, and it's just, well, God's waiting for you to learn the lesson and to follow the Spirit, not the flesh, and then up you go. So please explain if my thinking is right. And I say a rereading of Galatians 5 should help to rightly divide the good works from the Spirit of the Spirit from the bad works of the flesh. Sin cycle repeats itself for Christ's body members in a range of ways, depending on their background experiences. The greatest sanctifier in the world, in my humble opinion, is Lord God's Word, because man, with his nose in between the pages of the Holy Scriptures, has less time to invest in worldly things. Think about that carefully. Read from the Pauline epistles every day. Strengthen the inner man that's inside of you. And then whenever the path is in front of you for spirit and flesh, guess which way you're going to go? You're going to go that spirit side. And then you're going to see God magnifying things in your life, multiplying spiritual things in your life, helping to see these things, these mysteries. That it's exciting for me as a minister to see God's children finding God's wisdom, seeing the three witnesses. I can remember seeing it myself, growing and maturing in Christ and being like a little kid, waking up in the morning. I can't tell you how many times I was up in the morning at 4:35 in the morning with my cup of coffee sitting here beside the desk, not this particular place, but you know what I mean. And being at that table, sitting at that computer, doing my research on the scriptures at 10:30 at night, and still haven't taken a drink of that coffee. My neighbor had to run. I remember a 3-day period went by when I was in this intense study. This kind of defines me, how intense that I am sometimes. He had to go and get me laxatives. I didn't have any. And I had worked myself to the point of exhaustion after 3 days, and I wasn't even drinking. I was in the spirit so much that I wasn't taking care of my physical body. So you have to kind of watch it, because you can seek for the spiritual things and you can be in heaven before you know it. Trust me on that part. So I had to drink lots and lots. Whenever I realized what was happening, came out of it finally, then my friend brought me the laxatives and I drank a ton of water. And then as soon as I started drinking the water, then I could feel bodily operations starting to kick in again. Because when you don't have water in your system, the first thing that your body needs to begin these processes is water, and you run it out of it. So anyway, just to give you an idea. So the greatest sanctifier in the world is God's living word. And then, so you see God's wisdom. So you see God's wisdom using his three witnesses, spirit, blood, and water. Very good. What can be done about helping others in your environment see these things too? Sharing these newsletters with others. Individual, see, if you're a newsletter subscriber, download the newsletter. Make yourself a little presentation. Include it as an attachment and send it to your little group. Let them benefit from that newsletter. Highlight things that you want to highlight. It's a good thing. That's one thing that you can do. That's just, I'm giving you an example from my perspective. Okay. So the worst thing you can do as a supporter is to start sharing the Dropbox folder link, because that's what you get. That's what you pay for, access to all these newsletters. That's access to, Terral03.com proprietary property. So that's what you pay for, even though it's only $2 a month. It's very valuable. It gives you access to things like this. Individual newsletters, share them. That's what we want. Then purchasing a mystery report subscription for a family member, a loved one, church member, may be the way to earn greater heavenly rewards. So it costs you $2 a month, and you're getting a heavenly benefit for it. And for those that are wondering, why am I in this 5-week program, before I go any further, it's for those we leave behind. That is, whenever I'm standing in front of the judgment seat, and the question is going to come up about, well, you think you're deserving these big rewards because you saw the black star coming, well, where's your evidence? Well, look at the evidence. There's plenty of it. And the things, my survival supplies, are going to be there when I'm taken. And those that are called to work with Elijah on the earth are going to use those supplies and be ready to go in the coming day of the Lord. So there's a method to the madness of the survival group program. It's not because we think we're going to be left behind, but you know 100% that you're a Christian. You can look in somebody's eyes and tell that they're a Christian, that they've obeyed the gospel. Or maybe they're called to be a kingdom disciple under Elijah and hear the gospel of the kingdom and go that way. You don't know, do you? Well, preparing yourself physically, survival group program, and spiritually, mystery report, you see. If you do both, then you're going to be ready physically and spiritually. Neglecting one or the other, like I was saying about neglecting my body, that's going to be the wrong path. So it's more difficult to do things that way. Yes, I could just sit on my hands right here, 5 miles from the coast, and just say, well, I'm going to be raptured anyway. No, that's no. That's not preaching. That's not walking what I'm preaching, is it? Well, that's no good. There's a reason that we're going there. Christians are there. We know we're being taken. And the things that we are putting together there, including our ability to manufacture nanosilver to kill contagions, infections, and Lyme disease and things that are coming. Oh, I mean, as a natural supplement, forgive me. Then there's a method to all of this, and it guarantees you the highest heavenly rewards. So if you want the highest heavenly rewards, you run the race as to win. You want to be in the front. Can't stand being in second place. These are the things that you're doing. If you're willing to be lower, you know, just skate by, then, you know, that's up to you. But I'll see you in heaven and be near as close as I can up to Christ, Paul, and Barnabas and everybody, and be looking down and finding those who, well, did things a little bit differently, made their choices a little bit differently. Let's just put it that way. So then starting your own YouTube channel. Do you know that every YouTube video that is uploaded to both of my channels are done under the common licensing, Creative Commons. So you can download any of these videos and upload them to any of your channel, any of them. There's no license. I give permission to everybody in the world to do that. That's why it's under Creative Commons. You don't have to write me for permission. Just do it. Other people are doing it. People write me and say, hey, you know, this guy's putting your videos up. I go, yeah, that's what he's supposed to do. Creative Commons. Everybody can do it. I hope that you will. All I ask is you copy and paste what's in the description box in your description box, sending people with my message back to my website so they can get more information. So that's another way that you can earn reward. I'm saying for those that are not coming up with their own ways. So this is ways that I can help you with my ministry to build things for your ministry. If you give a misreport newsletter to somebody, a subscription, they're going to get the newsletters. They're going to go, bam, you know what? This stuff's pretty good. Guess who gets rewarded? You and me. Okay, so then write your own articles, post them at christianforums.com. That's what I did for years and years and years. Or other Bible forums to help sow spiritual seeds. Never try to beat somebody in a debate. That's not what it's about. Many of you guys are writing me saying, you know, debate, you know, that you're debating. Okay, but that's not the goal. The goal is to sow the seeds and to water the seeds so that there nobody is going to be moved by your great debate skills. Doesn't work that way. The way it's going to work is you're going to give them these seeds, and then you're going to come back and water it, and God's going to cause the growth. Not just that, you're going to pray for them. You're going to pray for your enemies to see it. That's what gets God. God sees you trying to help other people. He sees you praying for somebody that spitefully used you, and you want them to see God's wisdom so bad, then it moves God. And all of a sudden, you're moving mountains that you couldn't do it before. Not because you were reading the Bible, not reading Pauline epistles every day. Not because you're walking the ways of the spirit, not the flesh. Not because of that. It's because that you wanted somebody else to see it as much as you want to see it. It's that willingness to be the teacher that helps you move from the plateau. Sometimes it's the flesh that's going to, you know, going the way the flesh will get you on a plateau that you can spin around and never get anywhere. I'm not saying that, but I'm saying sometimes what's on the plateau, you can do everything right. You can be looking above in the spirit and everything, but if you're doing it for a selfish reason, for your own rewards, that's why the survival group program is so important, because of what the program we're putting together for those we leave behind. It's for somebody else, knowing full well that it's not for us. Some people who want to criticize say, well, why do you even have it? Well, you don't need it. But if you will look at it through that lens, then you'll realize this is the thing to do. Well, if I have, especially if you have lots of resources, you have lots of money, what are you going to do? Take it to heaven, will you? Use it to help other people. Help that whenever you move those other people up the rungs of the pyramid towards Christ, that pushes you up too. It's like Amway. So then you water those seeds, having a Bible study Tuesday nights in your home, leading the congregation at your church. Those represent good spiritual deeds. You know, in your church congregation, they say, well, who is willing to lead? Are you the guy that raises your hand? Thing to realize, you don't need to know everything about the Bible to help somebody. You only need to know more than they do. If you're seeing God's wisdom, the three witnesses, you have a big advantage over almost everybody. Okay, so those are all good deeds, so long as you teach sound doctrine. So sometimes you're going to hear what sounds like in my voice and in my writing a critical, like, man, being really critical. And then that would be a reason to say, well, you know, thousand pardons if, but it's because this doctrine thing is critical. It needs to be right. There's a right and there's a wrong. And getting your doctrine wrong is going to ruin your heavenly rewards. Mixing kingdom doctrine with case doctrine, doesn't matter how much you're looking up or looking inward at heaven that's incarnate inside of you, the things above, where Christ is at the right hand of God. Doesn't matter how much you're looking there, how much inspired you are by the Spirit. If your doctrine's wrong, you see what I mean? We got to get the doctrine right. That's why you go back to the first Mystery Report newsletter back in December 2019, and it's on the two Gospels of the New Testament. The second one's the two churches. Then the four baptisms, the same pattern, you see it at the website, terral03.com. There's a reason for that. There's a pattern to it because we're building strong doctrine, the strong foundation. We have to get the foundation right, or everything we build on top of it is going to collapse. So it's like just look at me like the engineer out on the job site. We have blueprints. We're looking at it. This is an exacting thing. And we just want to get it right. Whether you're the foreman or the laborer or the supervisor, we're all working together for the same thing. So having the Bible study, so long as you teach sound doctrine that builds Christ's body members, because we're looking for that maturity. We all get there. The whole body matures. You're part of it, and those that you help bring along are part of it. So those of you guys that are coming along and seeing it, see, we're part of it. Other people need to hear it. So I'm like the eye. I can see this stuff really, really well. Happy to share it with you, but guess what? The body that's just an eye just sits there. It doesn't go anywhere. It doesn't pick up anything. The body of Christ needs hands. It needs feet. It needs a strong back. It needs muscles. It needs strength. It needs hearing. It needs all kinds of things. We are all the body of Christ, all of us who are believers. I'm doing my part, but the eye can't lift a darn thing. The hands, you're the hand, you do the lifting. You're the feet, you do the walking. You're the ear, you do the hearing, you see? All of us work together, and we're placed inside the body just as God desires. So I've got my part, you got your part. Mine's not any more glorious than anybody else's. I have mine, you have yours. It's like your body walking down the road. It takes all the parts to get there. Arms swinging, legs going back and forth, head centered so you're not falling everywhere. It takes a body thing, the whole body, not just part. Now this is getting too long. I'm greatly enjoying sharing with you guys. And so health questions about Jerry's asking Doug. You want guys to go into more information on that. Obviously, the coronavirus is what's on everybody. South Korea, the churches are stopping meetings. The things that are happening in China, Korea, Italy, watch, they're coming here. These other stories are very important because they are closer to the source that's coming to the United States. The bug is one threat. What the government's going to do because of the bug is the next threat. I'm telling you for sure, you do not want to be in a big city. If you're sitting in New York City, LA, something like that, okay then. We'll see how that shakes out later in the timeline. Everybody's being warned, though, right? So, the six deaths. Washington State's getting hit hard. It's been here for a while, and I've already been saying the cat's out of the bag. This is the most. On the 2nd of February, this was 300. It was 3,000, or very close to, on the 2nd. So you can see how fast that it is growing. The U.S. showed 107. Remember, it showed 15 for quite a while. That 107 is in the thousands and thousands and thousands. It's already here. Long gestation period. They don't know it's here yet. They don't know if they have that or the flu. Regular flu. Signs of the times. Bernie didn't have a chance in my mind. Everybody's going to run towards the moderate, who is Gaff Biden, who has zero chance of beating Trump. So the Democrats are pretty much admitting defeat. If they're going to run to Biden, that's just because there's nobody left Bloomberg, he can't stand on the stage with Trump. It's going to be David and Goliath, except for Goliath is going to win in one round, 10-second knockout. So it just proves that you cannot buy the presidency. Trump did not buy the presidency. Or Bloomberg could do it, right? Right off under him. Not going to happen. So that's what I have to share with you guys. Appreciate your support very, very much. Get more information right here at the website. And we're going to have a Bible chat tonight at from 7 to 9 o'clock. Bring your questions, please. And if you're a supporter, please, if you're going to be a newsletter subscriber before you click on any of these buttons up here to get your Nano Silver, be a subscriber first. It's going to make it a lot easier because when your order comes in and I go to put your, I hit the return button on that to process you, it's going to say that your subscription status is MR and the date that you subscribed, Mr. Report, or Black Star newsletter. The designation is right on your subscription status. I'm looking right at it. If it says add contact list, you're not in my system. And you're going to get the lengthy, you have to be a subscriber, or happy to refund, to give you a refund. So that's what I have to share with you. Get your updated. You notice these were on two. Now you can get newsletter number 7 for the Mystery Report and for the Black Star. While that, as long as I'm not overrun, pardon me, with my Dropbox folder, that's going to continue to be a benefit for, you know, a YouTuber, for anybody that wants to come to the website, look around, watch the videos. Pardon me, that's right here. And thank you very much again, and I will see you. If you're just on this channel, you might want to also subscribe, which you can do right here, to the Black Star channel, because that's where most of my updates are going to be with all the coronavirus and everything. Thank you again. Get more information about all this, these things here at the website, and I'll see you on the next. Well, we're going to be in Bible study, and I'm going to record tonight, so look for that. That recording should be uploaded tomorrow morning.